So now we need to turn to an algorithm that allows us to have many SMs working on a single merge. Our strategy here is going to be to try to break up this one huge merge task that we need to do into a bunch of smaller merges, each of which can then be processed independently and in parallel by a different SM. So the algorithm for doing this is pretty cool. The goal is that when we're breaking up these two long lists, this blue list and this green list, into shorter sublists and then merging the results, that we don't have any subtasks that are too big to do on one SM. It's okay for us to have some smaller and some bigger subtasks, but we don't want a subtask that's too big for one SM. So here's what we're going to do. We have a big long list with tons of elements in it, and that's too big for us to be able to deal with. So what we're going to do instead is take a subset of each of these lists. In fact, what we're going to do is take every nth element of each of these lists. Let's say every 256th element. So we're going to create much shorter lists now. And so we're going to call these elements that we select splitters. And they're 256 elements apart. And our list here is going to be A, B, C, D, and so on. And our list here is going to be E, F, G, H, and so on. So then what we're going to do is we're going to merge these splitters to get a single sorted list, say E, A, B, F, C, G, D, H. Now, just as with the merge algorithm we defined a few minutes ago, we calculate the position of each splitter in the other list. So it's very straightforward for us to use the merge algorithm we already know to merge these two small lists of splitters. Note that the sorted splitter list already tells us in which sublist our splitter will appear, so just as before, we can do binary search for the exact position. Now, here's the cool bit. What I will submit to you is that we now have a sorted list of splitters, and the elements that fall between any two splitters in this list are an independent set that we can send to an SM and independently sort. So, the elements between E and A can go to one SM. The elements between A and B can go to another SM, and so on. So let's look at this in a little bit more detail with the elements between F and C. We can calculate the position of F in C's list. We can calculate the position of C in F's list. And so the work that we need to do for the pair defined by F and C is to merge this list with this list. And one of our goals was to make sure that none of these sublists would be too big. And we can guarantee that because we know that there are no more than 256 elements between F and G. And we know there are no more than 256 elements between B and C, so we can guarantee that there are no more than 512 elements between F and C. And so by choosing the spacing between the splitters, we can guarantee a maximum size on any of the independent chunks that we need to independently merge in the last stage of this algorithm. So the challenge we've addressed here, we take one big problem and divide it into a large number of small problems, each of which can be processed in parallel. So to sum up what we just did, we looked at three different phases of a merge sort, each of which we attacked with a different strategy. First, we used one thread block to solve many merging problems in parallel. Here, the number of problems was much, much greater than the number of SMs. Then we used one thread block to solve one larger merging problem. Here, the number of problems was on par with the number of SMs. Finally, we cooperated between all thread blocks to solve a single problem. Now we have fewer problems than SMs, so to keep all the hardware busy, we needed to find a way to divide the single problem into multiple independent problems so that we could keep all the SMs busy. And that concludes the merge sort.